right. Good morning, Midland. Won't you stand and sing some worship with us this morning?
That good. How are y'all doing? We are here. Y'all are here, and we're glad you are here. I'm glad you made it out here this morning. We're going to have Good time. It is summertime. We have had plenty of rain now. Your grass is looking good. You will have to cut it this week or pay somebody because it's growing. And we're grateful for rain. We're also grateful for some sunlight this morning. So we'll get out there and enjoy a little bit of sun before more rain comes this afternoon. But I'm so glad you made it in here this morning. When you came in, got picked up the bulletin, let you know some stuff coming up. You'll also see on there you got some QR codes you can scan during the service to check in. Let us know you're here. And also scan to give online if you'd like to do that this morning. So glad you made it. Turn around, look at somebody close by, tell them good morning, and we're going to keep on rolling.
Thanks for mouthing the words to me.
Yes. Man. Yes. Man.
Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in
Let's pray. God, as we come in here this morning, God, we're coming with hope of what you are going to do. We're coming in here with expectation for what you're going to do. And God, we're going to bring the best of what we have because we know that you can take what we've got and make it even better. And so as we come into this place this morning, bringing whatever we have this morning, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and we lay it before you, God, trusting that you are at work and God, that you are doing great things. So God, thank you for hearing our prayers. God, the names of all the people that we speak from our hearts this morning, God, the situations, the circumstances, the things that we're facing in our own lives that we're laying before you. God, the ones that we see happening in the world all around us that we know you're at work, but God, we are hoping and praying to see it more obviously, laying it before you and trusting in what you do and asking you, God, to equip us and ready us to do all that you've called us to do in your name. God, may everything that we say, all the things that we do, bring glory to your name, because it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
All right, everybody, what is the most important thing that you say to someone when they do something nice to you? And louder? How easy is it to forget to say thank you? Really easy to not give. Why is it not easy? You just have to remember. I mean, it seems so simple, right? Do you know in our Bible story today, there are 10 people that needed some help? How many of them do you think said thank you? Zero to one, huh? Not good. I think we might need to go read our Bible. What do y'all think? I see some of you got one up and some of you have zero. I'm not going to tell you the answer. You have to go read the story. Y'all ready? Let's say a quick prayer, and then let's go find out how many people actually know how to say thank you in our story. Y'all ready? Hands together for me. Dear God, thank you for loving me, for helping me, and reminding me to be thankful. Amen. All right, y'all, watch each other's fingers.
That is a really pretty guitar, and I don't want to knock it down. You know what I'm saying? So sorry, I'm taking longer than normal. So how was life, really? Is it all right? It's been quite a week of, like we talked about, some rain, some sunshine, some green grass, some fun times, some hard times. We got some stuff coming up here at Midland that I think really give us a chance to be together as a church and do the very thing that we feel we kind of are here on the corner to do. We got Vacation Bible School coming up now, and we're just a couple weeks out. We got a big party happening after this service today to help decorate and start getting more and more stuff set up. If you haven't been down, you can walk down the hall a little bit out here and look in some of the classrooms. Are already getting there. There's an awesome tree out there with roots hanging from it, you know. Spines, I know, but I call them roots every week wrong, and they have to correct me, and It's out there. It looks really good. Got it happening today after this service. So if you don't have anywhere to go, or if you would rather choose to do great work here, stick around a little bit. You can do some fun just decorating. As I've told you every week, it does not take great skill and talent, because I don't have much of that, and yet I get to be a part of it. So we're going to do a little bit of decorating today, and then that's coming up on the 25th or the 29th. And so if you haven't got signed up for it, you want to volunteer, you can do that online. If you've got kids, you've got grandkids, you've got friends with kids, and they want to get signed up, you can direct them right there to get signed up online and get those spots in. 25th to the 29th, 5:30 to 8 o'clock here at the church. It's a ton of fun. It is exhausting and tiring by Friday. You'll be ready for Friday night to take a nap. But to get to see the work God has done each year through all the different roles that get played, from the folks in the kitchen who are here earlier to get dinners ready, to folks who are with kids and they're crazy kids, to the ones who are with kids and they're the most, obedient kids. They're going, what in the world have these parents done and how can I do it? To the times when the kids are listening so closely to not, to see what God does in all of those moments each year is absolutely great. So just go on the marker calendar, make sure you got that on there ready. It's coming up soon, and lots of different ways to help be a part of it. As I said earlier, you can also give online. So if you want to scan right there the QR code on the bulletin, you can do it that way, text to give, or go through the website that way. We have tonight at 4:30, we have Bible study for men and women back on here at the church again. So all men, all women invited to come out. The men have typically been meeting down here. Women have typically been meeting upstairs. So come on out for Bible study. Be a part of that. Also want to let you know that on Friday, a week from this past Friday, this upcoming Friday, we're going to have a service here at the church. And we're calling it just a gathering because it's not going to be as serious as the service was for us in Orlando, but a gathering to celebrate and to remember Ashton, Jane. And so we're going to be getting together right down here, and a chance just to tell some of the stories, be there with the family as they're just getting back into town, I believe, today. And so that's Friday, 6 o'clock. I want to invite all of y'all to come on out. There's also, as you may have gotten the email last night, a place where you can sign up if you'd like to do a dinner for the family sometime. There's a link on there where you can do a dinner for the family in these upcoming weeks. We want to be there for them, but we don't want to be in the way for them. So we're here to love them, walk with them however we can. So just kind of want to let you know that that is happening this Friday. All are invited to come out to this space here. Tomorrow night, last one, we got a meeting happening down here too. It's the Administrative Council meeting. This is where we talk about some of the business of the church, but also celebrate the big things that have been going on and look ahead to what we have coming in the ministry side. So you're all welcome, always invited to be a part of those meetings if you'd like to come as well. 6 o'clock tomorrow night in this room. I think that's got it. I think that's good. Y'all good? Did I miss anything? Road trip. All right. Road trips are fun. How many of you done a road trip this summer? Hey, you may not have seen me for a couple of weeks, whatever. I got one coming up. I'm going to drive around some. It's going to be fun. We talk about road trips and how this goes. We've been laying it out in light of our faith through the trips that take place in the book of Acts in the Bible. Luke, Acts, just a kind of reminder, Luke, the Gospel of Luke, and Acts are all really one book. We just chose, when we put the Bible together, to stick John in between them. So, but Luke, Acts, one book, Jesus' life, and then the early church is how it kind of goes. We're working our way through there and looking at these road trips that have taken place back in the early beginnings of the church and things that we can draw from them, learn from them, for our life today as a church and in our lives just as family and folks in the world today. And so the first week, we put a question out there of where do you begin? And if you've ever been on a trip, planned one, you always have to figure out where do you begin? Where does all this get started to get the trip going? And as we read through them, we're looking at it not just obviously for us planning a trip, to literally travel around, but for us as a church taking the next steps and moving forward in these months and years to come and things that you can look at in your life. We said, a great road trip for us requires taking a chance. You can plan out the best you can. You get all the plans in order, but you know as well as I do, if you've ever tried, not all the plans will come to be, right? There'll always be things that you'll have to adjust on the fly. Taking a chance. And for us, this is a really big part, inviting the Holy Spirit to make it possible. And going, God, we're inviting you to move and work among us to make possible what needs to be done. Very big part to begin, and that's where we got it all started. On week 2, we went to what some people consider the most important question you can ask, and that's the why question. If you've ever been through life, you can hear the TED Talks and all kinds of other parts that will argue the most important question when you're coming up on decisions to be made in life, places to go, what to do. The why question matters. Why do we pick that road trip? Why do we pick to go that way, to take these things on, to see these places? Why? The why question. And as we were looking at it and reading through the stories of the early church, we actually found that this sets us up for another question that's really worth asking to kind of move in this direction. And what we said was, when you begin to look at things, as a church, we got to ask the question, are we feeding the fall and cultivating the motive of personal gain and excitement in the name of Jesus? And as we look around at the way we oftentimes market church, we oftentimes will put it up as the best experience of your life. If you'll come see us and worship with us, you'll never regret it. And though that may be a great thing, and we trust that God moves and God works, we also know that doing something every Sunday at some point, there will be a time when you go, that was awesome, and other times you'll say, that was another week. That as you get up in your life and you begin it with a prayer, every day will not be better than the last day. There will be days you will begin with a prayer and it still won't be as good as the day before, right? And there's something about the way our culture works that's brought us to a place that sets us up for failure in life and absolutely a lack of satisfaction at any point. And so the question we put out there, that as we talk about being church, are we feeding the fall and cultivating the motive of personal gain and excitement in the name of Jesus? Is that what is compelling us to do what we do? Which then brought us to, after looking at the why question, looking at this idea of when. You see, because when you hit a detour or make a wrong turn, you will be compelled to think it's over. And everybody's been there before at times in life. You're moving along, things are going well, and then something comes up, and boom, you're like, we are 300 miles off course here. There's no way we're making it back in time for that place we were supposed to be, that we had it all set up for a fun adventure over there. We're going to miss it. And some people will say, you know what, that means the trip's over. That was the part I was looking forward to the most. If we didn't make it there, none of the rest of this will be as fun. And so we said, when you hit the detour or make the wrong turn, you will be compelled to think it's over. But sometimes we just need to remember this is not the end. And this is one of the amazing things that can happen in life. When you think you're finally building up to the best part, the most exciting part, what you've been looking forward to, and it doesn't turn out the way you had hoped and dreamed of, we often think it's over. And yet God still does something. And this is the great thing about our faith. Which brought us to 2 weeks ago, as we, our last time of looking at this adventure here, we said, we're asked the question, who are you traveling with? And this is a really big question and very important, because we found that it's very important how you handle disputes. We've all been in the car at some point that we wish somebody hadn't come on the trip with us, right? Don't lie. Even when it was only two of you, all right? We've also been on that trip where there was more than one car going to the same place, and we stopped for a potty break, you know, because you suddenly just had to really go to the bathroom. Oh my goodness, we just got to find a place to stop. Now you're like, you know, I think I'm going to ride with them now, you know? You ever been there before? You know what I'm talking about, right? This idea of who you're traveling with really matters. And the deal is, as we begin to think about it and we go through life, the way you handle disputes that will come your way in life will be very important. And the problem is, and we're going to look at this, this is going to be echoed a little bit today, that we often come to this place of saying, who's right, right? Who's right? Who's right here? Pick, me or them. You ever been in that place? Whether it be your kids, you know what I'm saying? Whether it be brothers and sisters, whether it be your parents, you know what I'm saying? Came to you like, who's right? They lay their case out and you have to pick one or the other. We say, here's the deal. It's not about who's right when it comes down to our trip, the work we do as a church. It's about what's our purpose. And we found that as there's a dispute between Paul and a very good friend he'd been traveling with for some time, instead of picking who's right, they just went their own way to continue on with the very purpose they got started with in the first place. And that's how we are as a church as well. How do we continue to move for the purpose that we gather together? We said this. We asked the question, can we stay united around our purpose and not allow the other things, those things, to sabotage it? Which brings us to this morning. Y'all caught up now? Who, what, when, where, all that good stuff? All right. So this week is 4th of July. How many of y'all shoot fireworks for 4th of July? Yeah, okay, not many around here. We shot fireworks for 4th of July. My brother-in-law is very big on shooting fireworks, and so he will make it happen for us. The problem is we still have the little kids in our family, so when we shoot fireworks, we do small fireworks. You know what I'm talking about? We don't do the very big ones yet. We do just a couple of those that are loud, and we do like one at a time, boom, you know, kind of thing. The problem this year Nothing against, you know, our fireworks are great for young kids, but they were happening all around us, and you could walk out, like in the road we live on, because we live in a neighborhood, and you could just kind of look around the corner, and there were like these amazing fireworks happening all around us. So like as our kids are going to light, you know, whatever that ping is, you've got the family kind of looking around, and it's, oh yeah, good, you know what I'm saying? Y'all been there before and seen these things kind of happen? There's something really good happening all around. We love it. Now, when I was a kid, we were not allowed to shoot fireworks here in the state of Georgia. Y'all remember these days? Anybody remember this? It was like you got a sparkler and that was it. But we live on the border, you know what I'm saying, here in Columbus. And so when it comes New Year's Eve or right there around 4th of July, we would cross the border, right, into that other town. They talk funny over there. I don't know. You think we talk funny over there? You just go across the border. They talk funny over there in Alabama, all right? And so we cross over to anybody? Man, I tell you what. Yeah, see, in the back, I saw a hand kind of come around, like I'm trying to relax right now, you know, as we talk about Alabama. I think it was someone related, you know, that it was giving me the eye at 9:30, because we got a lot of Alabama fans at 9:30 service. I'm not sure if y'all are here at 11 o'clock, too, but they were like, oh, you're talking trash now. We're about to go down, you know. You know, talk about football again? Let's talk about football. You know, I was like, I'm not talking about football. I'm talking about Jesus right here, you know. But we would cross the border, we would go into Alabama, and we found a couple spots. We'd stop, and we would sneak our fireworks back across the border. You know what I'm saying? And this is like when I was first able to drive. I can remember taking my Ford Ranger over there, me and my brothers cramming in there, going over there, buying us some fireworks. And then, as we got older, it became okay. And I'm sure, still not sure exactly what the law says, but they sell these fireworks that we can shoot now, right here, and I am so grateful for my freedom, which 4th of July is what we're celebrating our freedom in the first place, is it not? Yes, Georgia finally caught up. I know, I know. There's something about freedom in life that we value, that we long for, and when you tell me I can't do that, I want to claim my freedom. You ever been there? You know what I'm talking about, right here. So we've crossed the border. I'm shooting my fireworks anyway. I don't care if you pull up in my, okay, I do care if you pull up in my driveway and tell me I'm in trouble, you know, and I'm going to try not to get caught. But this is the interesting thing. When you think about freedom in life and the ability to choose what you want, we are also people, and maybe you're saying, that's not me at all, Stephen, that will come to the time and you will be like, I just don't want to have to make another decision. Do I really have to choose again? You've been here and you're trying to pawn it off on somebody else. You decide. I'm not deciding, you decide. And as much as we love freedom and we want to do what we want to do, it will come a time when we will say, there are too many decisions I have to make. And one of the reasons, I think, maybe the main reason, is that all decisions come with consequences. That's right, all of them do. And you know this, I talk about this regularly. I've told you the story about Emma Kate, you know, quoting me to fix me one day. We know that. When you make a decision, every decision comes with consequences. Sometimes they're great consequences. They're just what you've been working for and hoping for, and you did it, and it happened. There's those other times that it is nothing like what you had hoped for, planned for, or worked for. Those times, those consequences were not the ones you expected, but they're amazing. They weren't the ones you expected, and they are awful, right? All decisions have consequences. Well, I want to look at a story today because freedom matters to us, and we celebrate it this week with 4th of July and our Independence Day. And I want to read a story. We're going to look at this kind of freedom where we have to make the decision. We have a freedom to make a decision. And yet understanding that the consequences that come with this, come with it, can be very difficult through the eyes of Paul. We have a story from Paul here, which, by the way, I'm just going to tell you now, is a greatly debated story of Paul. I was reading up on this one a good bit and just seeing what people have to say. There are people that will argue that in this story, Paul is the one who gets it wrong. There will be people who will argue that in this story, Paul did not get it wrong. He had a choice and he picked what he picked. And so I want you to see where you fall as we read through the story. This is Paul coming up to a big decision in life as he's going through ministry in Acts. Now I want to set it up with a passage from Romans. How many of y'all are familiar with Paul's letter to the church in Rome? Y'all familiar with that? Romans, if you want to read a book that really has a lot of deep theology in it to ponder daily, read Romans. All right, don't pick that as your first Bible study to do with your new group. That's a horrible decision. That is not a wise decision. You should not do that. All right, if you do, God will bless you, I'm sure. But it is crazy hard. It is a thick book. But there's this part, Romans 9 through 11, which I tell people all the time, if you really want to wrestle with Scripture, go read that sometime, because you have Paul in there where he claims that, you know, the Jewish people are God's people. When he says the Jewish people are all wrong, when he says, you know what, we're all a part of this, when he's saying, you know what, you're going to get cut off and thrown out, we're all in, we're all out, I'm going, everybody's going to heaven, nobody's going to heaven, read through it sometime, all right? And you see Paul going through the battle within our minds as we try to understand God's work and the way theology, the study of God, has impacted the way we understand the world around us. He gets this whole section started in Romans chapter 1 or chapter 9, verse 1, by saying this: I speak the truth in Christ. I'm not lying. My conscience confirms it through what? The Holy Spirit. The what? The Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit shows up throughout the book of Acts. Each week we've talked about how the Holy Spirit is moving in these works by the early folks that are followers of Jesus. I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were cursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my people, those of my own race. And who is that? The people of Israel, the Jewish people. And Paul is speaking about his great heart for the Jewish folks. That's who he is. He is a Jewish man. It's where he grew up. We know about his passion before the road to Damascus to be a part of this movement in the Jewish faith that then became, I'm no longer a Jew, but I am now one who is a follower of Jesus. And he, if you've read the stories of Paul, you know at some point he goes, you know what, to heck with trying to reach out to all of my Jewish friends and families and in different towns that I have grown up with and known. I can't seem to do anything. I'm going to the Gentiles because God has called me to go speak to those other folks that aren't Jewish. And he begins to do that. Now, in Acts, back to where we've been over this month out of Romans, back in Acts, we've heard Paul's heart for his people. Back in Acts, he's now coming to the end of his ministry. We're in these last chapters of Acts starting this week, and in 2 weeks we'll wrap it all up. And it seems Paul's heart is once again longing to be with his folks, to do something for the Jewish people. He's been traveling from town to town and ministering to the Gentiles, and now he feels God has put it on his heart to go to the Jewish people. In fact, as we pick up this story in chapter 20, we've had Paul traveling along. He's been traveling from place to place to place throughout Acts chapter 19. He's gone through Macedonia and Greece, and he said, now I'm going on to Jerusalem, which is about a 600 and something mile trek, which is that's a pretty far travel. I don't like that with kids in the car, much less walking that, you know what I'm saying? And then I'm going to travel there, he says, to Rome, which Rome was a little over 1,400 miles from Jerusalem. So he's up for a big road trip here. You know what I'm talking about? And as he gets started heading to Jerusalem, he says, it's because the task the Lord has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace to change the minds of my Jewish family. Now, in Acts chapter 20, verse 16, we pick up Paul along the way. And just to kind of get Paul's mindset as he's going, here's what he says. Paul had decided to sail past Ephesus to avoid spending time in the province of Asia. He's already been there before. He's already done work. And he goes, every time I get there, I get stuck there. You ever had friends that every time you go to their house, you know you're going to be there for 3 days, right? That's kind of what he's saying here. We ain't doing that again, guys. Why? For he was in a hurry to reach Jerusalem. Anybody ever here been in a hurry before, right? Here's Paul in a hurry to reach Jerusalem, if possible, by the day of Pentecost. I'm not making it by Passover, but I'm going to try to make it by Pentecost, this time of celebrating the harvest, this time that we've read about, right, where it all got started for us in Acts chapter 2, Pentecost, where the Holy Spirit moves and lives are changed. They hear this message. This is where he wants to be, and he's in a hurry to get there. Keep that in your mind. So pick up a little bit later on, verse 22. Paul says, and now, compelled by the what? Does that say Holy Spirit? No, it doesn't say Holy Spirit. It says Spirit. It's capitalized in NIV. If you're following along in your Bible, it may not be capitalized. It is just the word Spirit. And we are now left with this, you know, kind of decision to make. Is it the Holy Spirit? Is it within Paul? Paul feels compelled. It's argued a lot. But here's where we have it. Compelled by the Spirit. That's where Paul finds himself. I am going to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there. I'm going. I made a decision, I'm going to Jerusalem. I only know that in every city the Holy Spirit, that is there, go look it up, original way it's written out, it is Holy Spirit here, warns me that prison and hardships are facing me. You know, as God's been working and moving in my life, the Holy Spirit has warned me, I know it's coming. Everywhere I go, it's a tough time. It's not easy. But I got to go. I got to get to Jerusalem. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. And that's what I'm all about. Now, this is a very strong statement for Paul. In fact, we're going to read in 2 weeks that Paul actually does kind of care how it goes for him, and he's going to argue for his life in a couple of weeks here. Ever been really excited about something in life? You're really excited about it, and you make a claim, and you go, dadgummit, you know what I'm saying? I wonder sometimes if this is not Paul going, I'm on fire for it, it's going to happen, and you get there, and you go, dang it, why did we do this, right? I'm not sure if that's Paul all the time. He's very excited, very passionate about this. He's making the call. It's on my heart, the Spirit, whether that is the Holy Spirit or whether that is just within him, he feels in his heart, he's got to get to Jerusalem. He's going off to testify to the Jewish people the good news of God's grace. Now, this is all set up for our main text we're going to read for the story today. Y'all good with this so far? This is a lot of prep work to read this story now. All right, a lot of prep work. I know, but the sermon's not going to be 2 hours long. All right. Acts 21, right after this, he set out on the journey. And we pick up here in Acts 21. After he'd torn ourselves away from them, he'd been at a place there and they had been ministering to them and talking with him, spending time, eating those last meals together. He's told the people, I'm not going to be back. You know, I've got a long trip ahead of me and I'm not sure how well it's going to go for me. And I'm probably not going to be back. So this is probably our last time. People are sad seeing him go. After we'd torn ourselves away from them, we put out to sea and sailed straight to Kos. The next day, we went to Rhodes and from there to Patara. We found a ship crossing over from Phoenicia and went aboard and set sail. That's a good idea. You know what I'm saying? After you walked a little while, riding the boats, good plans. 614 miles away. After sighting Cyprus and passing to the south of it, we sailed on to Syria. We landed at Tyre, where our ship was to unload its cargo. Nice details. Very important from the author here going, hey guys, I'm recounting this trip for you. Big story's coming up, and I want you to understand. I was there, I experienced it, and this is how it went. Nice details the author's given us through here. We sought out the disciples there, and we stayed with them 7 days through the Spirit. Oh, here it comes again. This is the big part. That's why I referenced it earlier. What does it say? Through the Spirit, same one, pneuma, not Holy Spirit, just the Spirit. Through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. What's Paul on this journey for? In a hurry to do what? Get to Jerusalem. I'm in a hurry. Ever been in a hurry to get somewhere? This is how it works for me. Emily, check the traffic. Stefan, we're just pulling out of the neighborhood. I know. Check the traffic, right? You know what I'm talking about? And I bother her, like, you know, check the traffic. Check the traffic. Any red lines on there yet? Are we going around Atlanta? Are we going through Atlanta? Check the traffic. Like, I feel like that's how I picture Paul in my head, just like the rest of y'all do that too. Don't lie, all right? Paul's like, I'm getting there. I'm in a hurry. We know where his heart is. We read it in Romans when he wrote to the church in Rome. He said, my people, that's why I'm stopping in Jerusalem before I come to Rome. My people in Jerusalem. I'm in a hurry to get there. And yet, through the Spirit, they urged Paul not to go to Jerusalem. In fact, if you read somewhere, they say that that is actually a tamer way to say it. They were saying, stop, don't go any further. You can't go to Jerusalem. They felt very adamant about something within them compelling them to tell him to stop. Story keeps going. But was actually taken out of a lot of translations. But when it was time to leave, we left and continued on our way. But Paul said, I'm doing what I want to do, man. It's on my heart. I'm going to Jerusalem. All of them, including wives and children, accompanied us out of the city, and there on the beach we knelt to pray. After saying goodbye to each other, we went aboard the ship, and they returned home. We continued our voyage from Tyre and landed at Ptolemais, where we greeted the brothers and sisters and stayed with them for a day. Leaving the next day, we reached Caesarea and stayed at the house of Philip. Week two, y'all remember week two of this series? Philip was the one that went out there and had the crazy guy in town that was already the hit, and Philip started getting some, you know, and stayed at the house of Philip, the evangelist, one of the seven. He had 4 unmarried daughters who prophesied. After we had been there a number of days, a prophet named Agabus came down from Judea. Prophet. Someone who speaks to what is to come, right? Not necessarily being able to predict the future, but one who's very good at going, if you stay on this track, this is where you're going. He comes down from Judea. Coming over to us, he took Paul's belt. How awesome would that be? Somebody walks into the room from another town nearby, comes up and takes your belt off, right? You're like, what the heck is happening right now, guys? Right? I got a trip to take. I got stuff going on. He took Paul's belt, tied his own hands and feet with it, and said, the Holy Spirit. Ooh, here we go, right? See where this is going? The Holy Spirit says, in this way, the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. That's one way to communicate it, right? If anybody ever takes my belt and wraps himself up with it, I'm going to be questioning lots of things that they say, all right? But here's what he says. The Holy Spirit, and this is what this man was known for. He was known throughout this area to be the one that would come and speak things of going, man, if you keep this up, so maybe you'd call him a wise man, someone who's very good at seeing where things were taking place. Maybe a man who God really did speak to his heart. He says, look, the Holy Spirit has put it on me. In this way, the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem will bind the owner of this belt and will hand him over to the Gentiles. Not good news for Paul. And so, when we heard this again, Luke speaking here, he's been traveling around, first person talk a lot here over the past couple weeks. When we heard this, we and the people there did what? Pleaded with Paul not to go to Jerusalem. All right, man, it's coming up again. Have y'all ever been here before? You know what I'm saying? You're going through those times, you're like, I got to make a decision. And people are like, that's a bad decision. It keeps staying on your heart. You're like, I don't know, I just feel like it's what I got to do. Then Paul answered, why are you weeping and breaking my heart? I'm ready not only to be bound, but also to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. Paul's reiterating again. I said it before, I'm still there. I'm willing to die for him. When he would not be dissuaded. Do you have anybody in your life like that? Are you that person? We gave up. This is in the Bible. And said, the Lord's will be done. And we pleaded with him. And we told him over and over again, Paul, don't do it. Now's not the time. Maybe later, but look, I know what's going on in Jerusalem. I know how they're talking about you there. Don't do it now. And he said, why are you weeping for me? Why are you trying to tell me what I need to do? I don't care what comes my way. I'm going. This has been on my heart now. I've traveled this far, and it's going to happen. We would not be dissuaded. We gave up. We said, the Lord's will be done. And after this, we started on our way up to Jerusalem. That's where we're going to be in 2 weeks, on the way up to Jerusalem. As you read through this story, you see it happening, and maybe you've been there before. We got right here where Luke and the people in Caesarea are pleading with him not to go right after this guy has come in. They told him, didn't tell him not to go, right? Agabus didn't say, you can't go to Jerusalem. He said, if you go to Jerusalem, it's going to be bad. It's going to be tough. And Paul's response was, when's it not tough, right? And then you had that other church that also had pled with him. No, please don't do anything but go to Jerusalem. And yet the story wraps up after this. We started on our way up to Jerusalem. Seeing Paul's determination in the story, Luke said that they gave up and they said, the Lord's will be done. In these remaining chapters that we're going to look at in the book of Acts, Paul is arrested and in jail for his last 4 years. You know, as we come to these times, there it is, 4 years in jail. We come to these times in life when we have to make a decision. What do you do when the right thing to do isn't obvious? What do you do when the right thing to do isn't obvious in your life? How do you handle those times? Pray. How do you handle those times? Talk to somebody. How do you handle those times? Go back in all the past experiences in your own life, right? All right, this one time when I did this. And you come to this place, it's like the fork in the road where you got to decide which way you're going to go, and you got all these different voices speaking to you. And the question is like, you know, do you listen to the voice in your head or do you listen to the people around you? Have you ever been here before? I've been here a number of times. Don't lie. You know you've been here. You've been having something on it's on your heart, just like Paul said. It's on my heart. I just feel like I got to do it. And as you tell people about it, they all look at you and go, how dumb are you? And you're like, what are you talking about, dumb? This is, man, I got to do it, right? And how many of you followed through with it? And it was amazing. And it worked out just like you told everybody else, right? And you went, told you so. And how many of you have done it? And you went through with it and you went, dang it, I should have listened, right? We've been here at life and we've had these times where this idea of, do you listen to the voice in your head? Do you listen to what's on your heart? And you try to discern, like I try to put it before y'all today as we read the text, the Spirit. God, is that you talking to me or is that within me, just myself talking to me right now? Been there before? Probably. And you're just trying to discern what voice that is speaking, right? Paul had to pick who to listen to and trust that whatever would come his way because of that choice, this is the main point, God was still at work. And see, this is the part I think that's so important in our faith. I wish this morning, you know, when I was looking, I was going through, I'm reading these stories, and I'm going, wow, this is so real life right here. I feel like all of us have been to that place in life, if we're honest. Now, some people lie to themselves frequently, I think, and they're like, oh, never. God always speaks to my heart, and I always get it right. And I'm like, you know what I'm saying? Let me go back and refresh you on some stories that I lived alongside you, you sorry thing. You know what I'm talking about? We come to those places in life where we're trying to discern, God, is that on my heart because you're speaking to me? Or God, is that on my heart because it's just on my heart right now? God, am I supposed to listen to all these people around me that are telling me I should or shouldn't do this? Or should I listen to what's sitting on my heart right now? And it's difficult. And if you tried this and you've really paid attention to it, I bet you you've been at the places where you went with what was on your heart and it worked out really well. You went what other people had told you to do and it worked out really well. You went against what was on your heart to do what they told you to do and it went really well. Or you went against what was on your heart to do it and it was awful. And you say, I should have done what I decided to do before I ever talked to you, right? You've been at those places in life where you've talked to so many people and they're not telling you what you want to hear, so you keep going to find somebody else to talk to about, don't you? You've been there before? How many people you talk to now? I don't know, 72, 73? You know what I'm saying? I'm moving right now. I'm going to another place to talk to people about this. I saw a psychic down the road, never stopped at one before, but we're going to talk a little bit, all right? Because you want somebody to confirm that's on your heart. And as I was reading through and thinking about this, I was like, I want to figure it out. I want to know. But when it comes down to it, I couldn't come up with, and maybe you have it out there and you can tell me what the answer is. I wasn't able to come up with that magic word to tell you, that magic act, that thing to do, the right prayer to pray, to always get such clarity in what you're to do. That you will just know it every single time. And when you just know it, you'll always be right every single time. I couldn't find it. And what I found to be true is that at some point, you're going to have to pick. At some point, you're going to have to go. And at some point, you're just going to have to give it the best that you have. At some point, there will come a time. Sometimes it'll be perfectly clear. You will feel God has put it on your heart, and you will pick, and you will go, and you will do your best, and it will turn out. There will be times where you will pick, and you will have to pick, and you put it off as long as you can, and you're going to go, and you're going to bring the best you have, and your best will simply not be good enough, and the outcome you're expecting and hoping for will not be there. And I think this is what I've come to in my life. For all that I've tried to work on, all the times I've tried to get it right, to discern, to know it, is at the end of the day, it's not about your plans, but God's love. It's not about that you'll finally have all your plans right, because you will have listened good enough, you'll have read your Bible enough, you'll have prayed enough, that you'll have it all worked out, and all your plans will be right. It probably won't. Whether that's just the fallen nature of humanity, whether that's the power of our ego, whatever you want to call it, at some point, we'll have those times that I gave it my best, and yet it still did not work out the way I'd hoped, even the way I have prayed. And yet, it's not about our plans, but God's love. Because I believe God still does amazing things, even when our way's not working out. Even when our spirit whatever you want to call it inside of us, the voice within us is calling us to do something. And we're trying to discern, is that me or is that you, God? Is that my past experiences informing me, or is that you speaking to me now? Am I supposed to listen to those people or listen to what's on my heart? I wish, and if you have the answer, you can share it with us. You can do the benediction for us and share it, and we'll all leave happier people, right? But I don't know if it's out there. And I don't know if there really is a way to always know this is what you ought to do and you ought to do it now. But I do know this. We have an amazing God who still does, even when we don't get it right, amazing things. Who, even when we do get it right, does something even more amazing. And that's what my faith is in as we travel together on the journey in life. Let's pray. God, we come to those times in life when we're trying to figure it out. God, what's the right thing to do? What is the thing that we ought to do in light of all that's going on and where we find ourselves? In light of the situations and, God, the people we're with, the choices that are now before us. And it can be so difficult. And God, it can also be those times that it's put on us in your name that you're telling us what we should do. And we're just not listening. And God, maybe it is just our brokenness. Maybe it's our stubbornness. But God, we can't get it all figured out every single time. But this morning, God, we're going to rest in the assurance that you still do amazing things. And so God, in these weeks ahead, as we continue to read Paul's story and see the great work you do, as we look at our own lives and the things that you have done, may we have expectation of what you are to do, still great and amazing things. May the focus no longer be on us being able to figure it all out. But may it be on us being a people who lay our lives down before you and trust that, God, you still do amazing things. It's in your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to your feet as we close with a song this morning and the ushers pass the offering plates. Thank you. Go forth in peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. See y'all next week.